Today on Nerd of the Rings, we're covering the entire life and travels of Saruman the White, including his journeys to the east and his downfall in the Shire. Curumu was once a powerful Maia who served Aule, the smith of the Valar. Along with Curumu in this role was another Maiar who had come to be known as Sauron. As we know, in the Second Age, Sauron would begin his quest to conquer all of Middle-earth, overseeing the creation of the Rings of Power and creating the One Ring. In response to the actions of Sauron, Manwë, the king of the Valar, calls a meeting where it is decided they must send emissaries to Middle-earth to assist the free peoples. Curumu is the first to volunteer. The five who are sent are known as the Istari, or wizards, taking on the forms of old men. Curumu makes the journey to Middle-earth, becoming the wizard Saruman the White. While Saruman would volunteer to go to Middle-earth, Olorin, or Gandalf, was convinced to go by the Valar. Varda, the queen of the Valar, says that though Gandalf goes as the third of the Istari, he was not truly the third, implying that he was the most important of them all. This moment causes Saruman to become jealous of Gandalf. This jealousy would only grow over time. But Gandalf isn't the only wizard that Saruman has ill will toward. Before he leaves for Middle-earth, Saruman is ordered to take Eowyndil with him. This leads Saruman to forever after hold in contempt Radagast the Brown. Saruman, Radagast, and Gandalf would arrive at the Grey Haven sometime around 1000 of the Third Age. In Tolkien's earlier writings, the Blue Wizards came at this same time. However, in his later writings, they would arrive 2841 years earlier, in 1600 of the Second Age. Due to his great wisdom, Círdan perceives the identity and origins of the wizards. As Gandalf arrives in Middle-earth, Círdan gifts him Narya, the Elven Ring of Fire. Later, Saruman would learn of Círdan giving the ring to Gandalf, and his jealousy would turn into an even greater secret dislike of the Grey Wizard. After arriving in Middle-earth, Saruman travels to the east, the same location as the Blue Wizards. He would spend the next 1500 years in the east. What he did there, we can only guess. We know only that he would return to the west of Middle-earth after his 1500 year journey. In 2460, Sauron returns to Dol Guldur as the Necromancer, more powerful than his previous time in Mirkwood. What's interesting to note here is that Sauron had secretly fled Dol Guldur in 2063, when Gandalf first enters the fortress. He would spend nearly 400 years in the east, during the same time that Saruman and presumably the Blue Wizards are in the region. Now, Rûn is a rather large area, and years, decades, and even centuries mean little to immortal beings. But we can't help but wonder what happened during Saruman's time in the east, and whether he came into contact with Sauron or the Blue Wizards. What we do know is that Saruman was not corrupted during this time. While he may not hold his peers in high regard, he is not the fallen wizard we would see later. The Necromancer's emergence in Dol Guldur leads the Great and Wise to form the White Council in 2463. Initially, Galadriel makes it known that she believes Gandalf should be the head of the council, but Gandalf turns it down. Despite being named head of the council himself, Saruman is once again jealous of Gandalf. Even at this time, Saruman has begun to desire power like Sauron's, specifically the One Ring. After returning to the Westlands of Middle-earth, Saruman would make his way to Minas Tirith, where he studies in the archives, much as Gandalf would do centuries later. There, Saruman learns all he can of Isildur and the One Ring. Around this same time, the lands of Calenarthon are given to the Eothaid, thus becoming the land of Rohan. While Gondor would continue to man the realm of Isengard, the keys to the Tower of Orthanc are kept by the stewards of Gondor. Eventually, the line of these Gondorian chieftains would fail, and the Dunlendings would seize control of Isengard. From there, they would lead raids on the west fold of Rohan. In his studies, Saruman learns that one of the Palantiri is likely still in the Tower of Orthanc. These seeing stones could not only communicate with one another, but could also be used by the powerful to see across the world. Saruman offers Steward Baron of Gondor and King Freyjolf of Rohan to take up residence in Isengard. The two leaders welcome the opportunity to place a wizard at their northern border, and in 2759, he is given the keys of Orthanc. Saruman takes up residence in the tower, where he discovers the Palantir, which he keeps secret from the White Council. In 2851, as head of the White Council, Saruman vetoes Gandalf's appeal to attack the necromancer in Dol Guldur. However, 90 years later, as Thorin and company are on the quest of Erebor, Saruman discovers that the servants of Sauron are searching for the ring near the Gladden Fields. This leads him to agree to move against Dol Guldur. He hopes this will allow him to search the Gladden Fields for himself, unchallenged by Sauron's forces. In 2953, the White Council meets for the final time, where they discuss the Rings of Power. It is during this meeting that Saruman tells the others that he has discovered that the One Ring has passed down the Anduin and has been lost to the sea. After this meeting, he retreats to Isengard and begins to fortify it. His jealousy and fear of Gandalf now at an all-time high, he assigns spies to watch all of his movements. Seeing Gandalf's interest in the Shire, he places agents in Bree and the South Farthing. Around the year 3000, Saruman uses the Orthanc Palantir for the first time. What Saruman failed to realize is that the stone from Minas Ithil was now in the possession of Sauron in Mordor. Sauron uses the Ithil stone to bend the Orthanc stone to his will, and by extension, Saruman himself. Around this time, Saruman begins his efforts to seize control of Rohan. He enlists the assistance of Grima Wormtongue, the advisor to King Theoden. Promising him the Lady Eowyn as a reward, Saruman puts Grima to work, acting as his spy, and preventing Rohan from interfering with the growth of his army. Grima not only informs Saruman of Rohan's secrets, but also weakens King Theoden, both with words and with poison. At some point around 3018, Saruman sends Radagast the Brown to Eriador to seek Gandalf. Gandalf, having just confirmed Bilbo's ring to be the One, meets Radagast on the road, who tells him to go to Isengard. On July 10th, Gandalf makes his way to Orthanc, where Saruman discovers that the One Ring has been found in the Shire. At this point, Saruman finally reveals his true colors. He plans to be a ruler over men and to join Sauron, but also holds a desire to claim the One Ring for his own if he can. Whether by the knowledge of Sauron, ancient knowledge from the nearby destroyed Eregion, or by his own studies, Saruman had crafted a lesser ring of his own in an effort to emulate Sauron. We know very little of Saruman's ring, except that he wears it when he confronts Gandalf and refers to himself as Saruman Ringmaker. He also goes on to give himself a new title, Saruman of Many Colors. It is in this moment that Gandalf notices Saruman's robes are no longer white, but that they are woven of all colors, and as he moves, they create a bewildering effect to the eyes. In one of his more low-key insults, Gandalf simply replies, "I liked white better." Saruman goes on to make his pitch to Gandalf, that they should join with Sauron, for Sauron was now the power of Middle-earth, not the elves or the dying line of Numenor. By joining the Dark Lord, he says they can accomplish their high and ultimate purpose of knowledge, rule, and order. Gandalf refuses to join Saruman and is imprisoned atop the Tower of Orthanc. During the more than 2 months that Gandalf is prisoner, he witnesses Saruman's army amassing at Isengard. He sees hordes of orcs and wolves. Also gathering are groups of Dunlendings and Uruk-hai. Though Saruman's use of Radagast would deliver Gandalf to him, it would also be the means of Gandalf's escape. For Radagast had also given the message to Gwaihir, the Lord of the Eagles, to seek Saruman and Gandalf at Isengard. The Great Eagle rescues Gandalf and brings him to Rohan, where he takes Shadowfax and makes his way north to the Shire. On September 20th, the Black Riders arrive at Isengard, seeking the Ring and the Shire. Here, Saruman begins his open betrayal of Sauron, lying to the Nazgul by saying he doesn't know where the Ring is, despite having deduced it being in the Shire when speaking to Gandalf. He also tells the Nine that they would know if he had found the Ring, for if he had, the Nine would bow before him and call him Lord, implying that a being with such great power as Saruman could take full control of the One Ring, and by extension, the Ringwraiths themselves. He does, however, tell them that Gandalf knows the location of the ring, and to search for him nearby. Later that month, the Nazgul capture one of Saruman's spies, who reveals the wizard's treachery to the Witch King. Having now been exposed as a traitor to both Sauron and the White Council, Saruman puts all his efforts into getting the ring. He sends forth raiding parties of orcs on various routes that a company bearing the One Ring would likely take. He also attacks the realm of Rohan in the first battle of the Fords of Isen on February 25th. This attack was less about Saruman taking control by force than eliminating the threats to his conquest via his control of Theoden. There were two who stood in Grima's way of having full control of the king, Theodred and Éomer, Theoden's son and his sister's son, or nephew. Saruman orders an attack on the Fords with the command that Theodred is to be slain at all costs. In this, he is successful. Theodred dies from his wounds and is buried on the small island between the forks of the river. The next day, one of his raiding parties comes upon the Fellowship of the Ring at Amon Hen, where they kill Boromir and capture Merry and Pippin. However, Saruman's streak of luck would end as this band of orcs would be destroyed by the Rohirrim, led by Éomer on the outskirts of Fangorn Forest. Saruman's capture of the hobbits would directly lead to Merry and Pippin meeting Treebeard in Fangorn Forest. Now, there's some major differences at this point between the books and the films. In the films, Theoden retreats to Helm's Deep rather than risking open war with the Uruks of Isengard. It seems that the Rohirrim go to this abandoned fortress in a desperate attempt to hold out rather than being overrun at Edoras or on the plains of Rohan. In reality, Helm's Deep is closer to Isengard than Edoras, is manned by a garrison of troops, and Theoden immediately moves against Saruman, riding north with 1,000 soldiers to take the fight to the orcs. However, on March 2nd, the Rohirrim, that are now under the command of Erkenbrand, encounter the full forces of Isengard, 10,000 Uruk-hai, orcs, Dunlendings, wargs, and other evil men. The Rohirrim are scattered, and a rider named Kaorl comes across Theoden in his retreat, telling him of the massive force. Saruman, who ever since Gandalf's escape has been forced to rush his plans, has sent nearly his full strength to conquer Rohan and hopefully claim the ring. Gandalf perceives something in the distance in the direction of Isengard. He even asks Legolas to use his elf eyes, which are mysteriously obscured. In this moment, Gandalf advises Theoden to make for Helm's Deep, where they may hold out for a time as he rides north. You see, in this moment, Gandalf likely realizes that something is happening at Isengard, and the reason that Legolas's vision is obscured is the Huorns moving against Saruman, who were beings known to be able to cloak themselves in shadow. This is indeed exactly what was happening. The Ents are attacking Saruman. They surround Isengard, destroy its gates, break its walls and the dam. Isengard is flooded and sacked. Gandalf arrives and asks Treebeard for help. Helm's Deep needs the Huorns. From there, he goes to find Erkenbrand and amasses a cavalry of Rohirrim to aid the king. As we know, Saruman's army is utterly defeated at the Battle of the Hornburg the next morning. Gandalf, Theoden, and the victorious heroes of Helm's Deep ride to Isengard to parley with Saruman. Knowing he is utterly defeated, Saruman actually, very briefly, considers repenting for his actions. In the end, whether by his pride, his hatred of Gandalf, or believing Sauron would be victorious and forgive him, he could not repent. He uses one of his last and greatest weapons remaining to him, his voice. He attempts to talk Theoden and Gandalf into being allies once more, but this fails. The wizard's staff is broken, and he is expelled from both the White Council and the Order of the Istari. In this moment, Grima throws the Palantir of Orthanc at the group, not realizing how important an object it is. This would be the same stone that both Pippin and Aragorn would use. Aragorn, in order to draw Sauron into open war, drawing his attention from his own lands, and Pippin in one of his foolish Took moments. Saruman would remain a prisoner in his own tower for the next 5 months. On August 15th, he convinces Treebeard to let him depart, playing on Treebeard's pity for watching living creatures be imprisoned. Saruman and Grima make their way north, and on August 28th, they are passed on the road by Gandalf, Galadriel, Celeborn, Elrond, and the four hobbits. As the hobbits make their way to Rivendell with Gandalf and Elrond, Saruman and Grima make their way to Hobbiton. Weeks later, on September 22nd, the hobbits come to the Shire to discover it has been taken over by ruffians, aided by Lotho Sackville Baggins and commanded by a mysterious boss named Sharky. This Sharky is revealed to be Saruman himself, as Frodo, Sam, Merry, and Pippin lead the hobbits in regaining control of the Shire. As Saruman knows he is defeated, he takes some level of comfort in knowing that it will take the hobbits many years to undo the damage he has inflicted upon them. In this moment, when Saruman is at his lowest, Frodo has pity on him, even after Saruman attempts to kill him with a knife in a parting shot. In the end, Saruman's frequent mistreatment of Wormtongue would be his undoing. Frodo finally convinces Wormtongue that he need not follow the fallen wizard, but Saruman insults and scorns Grima once again, leading Wormtongue to slit his throat. Grima is shot by a hobbit archer as he flees, and Saruman dies a ruined and feeble version of his former self. As the hobbits stare in wonder, a mist like a spirit raises from the body and appears to look to the west, to the undying lands, home to the immortal beings. But at this moment, a wind comes out of the west, pushing the spirit away. This leads us to believe that, like Sauron, the spirit of Saruman is left naked and powerless, floating away into nothing. As always, I want to say a huge thank you to my Patreon supporters, including Tom DeBombadil 19, Gail Elizabeth, Jim Limber Davis, Sky Carcass, Salim Rahman, Smorzerk, Zetrock, Gimelkad, Grand Strategy Nerd, Debbie, Chief 40123, Mid-Earth Wellness, and the Dark-Haired One. Thanks so much for watching and subscribing, and we'll see you next time on Nerd of the Rings.